Good morning, dear audience. Thank you for coming to this nice presentation. We're a group of delegates from Ecuador, and we're going to briefly introduce in English the presentation, the abstracts, and introduce the people that are going to speak, all representatives of local communities, indigenous peoples from Ecuador, and they are going to speak in Spanish, which is not even their native language, but they're going to speak in Spanish, and we have somebody helping us with the translation. So I hope you can stick with us, and I hope we can have a nice dialogue afterwards. The title of our presentation is Plurinationality, Territorial Self-Determination, and Life Plans in Indigenous Nations and Afro-Ecuadorian Communities. So the abstract, in general terms, what we're going to speak about, the 14 nations and 27 peoples of Ecuador live in the country's best conserved lands and watersheds of the Pacific, Amazon tropical forest, and the high Andes. After long-term indigenous people struggles, they have been able to catalyze the constitutional recognition of Ecuador as a plurinational country, recognizing the different nationalities that exist there. Also underscoring the indigenous paradigm interpreted by others as a new development regimen, which is called El Buen Vivir, or Suma Causa, which originates from the indigenous Quechua language and can be translated into living well. Also, the constitution recognizes and underscores the rights of nature. It's one of the first constitutions on an international level that actually gives nature rights as well. In reality, however, after the discourse, in reality, market-oriented climate change mitigation and other economic development processes are, in essence, putting at risk indigenous and Afro-descendant communal territories and their historical adaptive-based livelihoods.
So Ecuadorian communities, peoples, and nations have been embarking on processes to apply their constitutional rights, guaranteeing the autonomy and the recognition of their territorial management, founded on their ancestral practices and knowledges. Searching out mechanisms that support territorial autodetermination, thus to guarantee the recognition of political rights to a plurinational state, the speakers will present their experiences on the following: developing life plans and political incidents in relation to state development plans, integral concepts of territorial forest, watershed, and mangrove management, and the creation of regional networks based on territorial autodetermination and defense.
Hello, I will present the speakers. We have four speakers that come from the grassroots communities in Ecuador from different regions of the country. And they will talk to you about their own experience, about how they are going and having their life plans. So we have Sonia Tanguila. She comes from the Quechua nationality in the Amazon basin. Mary Cuesta, she comes from the Pasto nationality in the highlands. Aquilino Erazo, he comes from the Pacific, the zone of the Pacific coast. He's an Afro-Ecuadorian. Manuel Taikus, he comes from the Awa nationality in the highlands and in the coast. Thank you.
Muy buenos días con todos aquí presentes. Yo pertenezco a la nacionalidad quichua de la Amazonía del pueblo Quijos. Hemos venido acá a traer un mensaje que es de vida para nosotros y que todos puedan escucharnos y entendernos qué es lo que queremos. En el caso de los pueblos y de las nacionalidades en la Amazonía ecuatoriana,
So she's going to talk about the case of the peoples and the nationalities in Ecuadorian Amazon.
Voy a explicarte lo que es cómo estábamos nosotros antes Porque para que nos entiendan un poco de lo que queremos hablar y qué es el mensaje que queremos dar aquí en presentes. ¿Cómo fuimos nosotros? Nuestros abuelos vivieron en un sistema de convivencia colectiva, en una unidad entre los miembros de las comunidades, supervivencia que se basaba en la conservación del medio. Es decir, que nosotros vivíamos todos en conjuntos, en unidad, sin, en equilibrio con la hombre y naturaleza. No necesitábamos de nada más que vivir de eso. El territorio se consideraba en forma integral. Los conocimientos propios fueron transmitidos de unos a otros. Nuestros conocimientos siempre estuvieron con nosotros. No estuvieron amenazados ni nada de puestos a... ¿cómo se dice? Invasión o golpeados por otras personas que nos vengan a imponer. Se aplicaba una forma de gobierno en la que las decisiones de los curagas, nuestros líderes, eran siempre en beneficio de todos, no solo de uno, y que estos estaban asesorados, estaban con donde estaban los sabios, los que son yachaks, los que nos impulsaban a seguir si esto está bueno o esto está malo.
So she started off by giving some background information about the topic. So their ancestors lived in a collective. Sorry, I'm a bit lost. Lived collectively in unity, with the other members of the community. It was based on. The way of survival. Sorry.
It was based on a way of survival in which they conserved their environment. And so for them, territory is not just a piece of land. It's an integral way of considering how the territory is fit together. And the knowledge of how to live and manage and administer this territory was transmitted from generation to generation. And it was never before in history, it was never this knowledge, this way of passing knowledge was never, how do you say that? It was never threatened. That's the word, very, thanks a lot. It was never threatened. And they applied a form of governance within their territory in which they had two types of leadership. One, which is the curagas, which she mentioned, which is the political leadership, which was passed on with regards to the behavior of a certain person. It's not a certain lineage or family lineage. It was the behavior of a person. And the other type of leadership was the yachaks. And these are the spiritual leaders. So what they also say is that the decisions that were taken were always in benefit of the collectivity. It was never from one person that was going to get more or get less.
¿Y ahora cómo estamos? Antes de empezar a leer, quiero decir que ahora con nuestro gobierno tenemos leyes que han estado a favor de nosotros, pero ese fue conseguido bajo la lucha de nuestros pueblos, de nuestras nacionalidades, y con eso hemos conseguido, pero también tenemos muchas dificultades dentro de eso. Una de ellas es la influencia de la sociedad occidental que rompe con la forma comunitaria y tradicional, creando necesidades. Y una forma de organización que responde al interés individual. Se propone desde el Estado crear los CTIs, asumiendo las formas de gobierno de Estado. En eso quiero decir que a nosotros nos vinieron a impulsar una necesidad, lo que no teníamos antes. A crearnos un desarrollo en donde nosotros no pretendemos estar enmarcados en una urbanización, en una de estas. Nosotros estábamos bien en la naturaleza, convivíamos con ellos. Y también en una forma de reivindicación, el gobierno nos propuso las CTIs, las circunscripciones territoriales, pero eso nos llevaba solo a hacer un cambio de nombre, no de profundidad, lo que nosotros necesitamos. Asumimos todos esos retos, pero ahora estamos pretendiendo algo más que estar solo con esas cosas. Pretendemos nosotros iniciar y empezar a enseñar cómo nosotros debemos hacer. Se debe considerar que el territorio es más que un solo espacio físico en que se debe determinar el uso del suelo en función al mercado. La actividad petrolera, las madereras y las mineras que atentan contra el territorio no se respete el principio del consentimiento libre, previo e informado. En eso también nosotros tenemos las dificultades de que en nuestros territorios se nombraron áreas protegidas, pero con el fin de conservar. Pero nosotros, ¿cómo? ¿No, acaso nosotros no estábamos conservando? ¿Acaso nosotros nos teníamos mejor que ellos, que solo por el nombre de áreas protegidas tienen todas las áreas protegidas tienen concesiones petroleras, mineras? ¿Eso no es destrucción para nosotros? Entonces, esas son formas de que nosotros estamos aquí queriendo dar un mensaje de vida de que también nosotros queremos proteger el bosque, la naturaleza en general.
So after what she mentioned that before the collectivity was the one that managed the territory, nowadays through the influence of modernity, let's call it like that if you wish, things are changing, yeah? And the community way of organizing themselves and managing and administering their territory is also being changed from this influence. The state, for example, now is proposing to create a indigenous territorial reserve, let's call it some way, in which the state will recognize certain rights. But this would entail that these reserves have to fit into the same apparatus and form of governance of the state, which in essence is not the way they used to manage their lands. So she says that even though these rights have been recognized, the way that the state conceives these things is not really respecting their ancestral way of how they used to work and work together to manage their lands. So the territory, as I said before, is not just a piece of land in which you determine how to use it or how not to use it. The land itself, the territory has all kinds of spiritual, emotional, and collective values which most Occidental people do not take into account. So she also mentioned that, for instance, the state is creating all kinds of protected areas within their territory, but does that mean that they didn't protect and conserve their territories before? And these protected areas have mining concessions, mining, gold mining, oil mining, and how does that influence? They call it a protected area, but in the essence, they want to develop extractive activities within this territory. The Constitution recognizes free, previous, and informed consent, but this, even if the communities do not agree in these mining activities, the state can decide, because the state is supposedly superior, the state can decide that we're going to do these mining activities anyways.
¿Cómo queremos ser nosotros ahora? Recuperar el summa causa, autodeterminación del territorio, gobierno propio, justicia propia, forma de vida propia, reconocimiento de la autoridad. En recuperar la summa causa va más allá de lo que significa en el español, que es el buen vivir. Para nosotros el summa causa representa más allá la armonía entre la naturaleza y el hombre, y no el sentido de que nosotros el summa causa o el Estado que nos venga a decir o tener un carro o una casa, provenirnos, no es eso. Para nosotros es vivir en equilibrio y tener un gobierno propio, que significa lo que es nuestro, cómo estamos viviendo. En aplicación a los derechos establecidos en la Constitución, hay el Estado plurinacional e intercultural, derechos de la naturaleza, derechos colectivos, y queremos que se aplique tal como es, no que nos vengan a interpretar como ellos nos dicen, sino como está en realidad, y que se aplique según lo que es. Y que nosotros determinemos qué estamos haciendo, no es que nos vengan a crear necesidad, sino nosotros vivimos con esas cosas.
So their proposal as a Quechua nation is to recuperate this living well concept, the summa causa, yeah? This new development paradigm based on indigenous cosmovision. And how do they want to do that? By strengthening their self-governance practices, by strengthening their customary law practices within their territory, by applying and strengthening their own forms and ways of life as they used to live traditionally, not within the new concepts of modernity, and recognition of territorial authorities as they used to have before. The Spanish colony imposed new ways of authorities which undermine their traditional authorities. So what they actually want to do is apply these concepts that the Constitution recognizes, but within their own perspectives, not within the perspectives of the state. So what they're mentioning, they really want to strengthen a plurinational state in which the intercultural aspects of Ecuador are recognized. They want to apply these nature rights in which government cannot just extract what they want, but they want to find a way, because the Constitution puts it nicely, but they haven't found a way to enforce these laws. And the same thing, they want to enforce what the Constitution says about collective territorial land rights.
¿Cómo queremos lograr? Estamos en el proceso, que es crear los planes de vida, una planificación de nuestra propia cosmovisión, uniendo sabidurías y voz entre pueblos, consolidándoles nuestras formas de vida y creando el respeto de nuestro conocimiento y sabiduría por un territorio libre e indivisible. Eso es lo que queremos lograr.
So in conclusion, what they want to achieve is by means of developing their own life plans as an alternative to the state development plans. They want to develop these life plans in their communities based on their own cosmovision, their own way of seeing their territory and their society. And this means that they have to unite the knowledge and the all the ancestral knowledge of different communities, not just one. This way they can consolidate their forms of life, their livelihoods, their own livelihoods, creating respect for their knowledge and their wisdom based on how they deal and interact with their environment. And the last sentence says, we're fighting for a free and indivisible territory in which we are the authorities. So the next speaker is the case of the Awá nationality in Ecuador, which are also in this frontier region of Ecuador with Colombia. I present Manuel Taikus, president of the Awá Federation.
Buenos días con todos. Manuel Taikus, presidente de la Federación de Centros Awá del Ecuador, reciba un saludo a nombre de quienes conformamos esta federación. Además de estar en el Ecuador, también la conformamos en Colombia, ¿no? En Colombia estamos 44,000. En el Ecuador estamos 4,500. Eso llegamos a un número de 48,500. Agua tanto en Ecuador y en Colombia. La Federación de Centros Agua del Ecuador es una organización de segundo grado sin fines de lucro de la sociedad civil. Se encuentra ubicado en el noroccidente del país ecuatoriano y también en el sur de Colombia, Colombia. En parte de eso llevamos una coordinación estrecha de la gran familia Agua que sería, pero en este caso la vamos a topar netamente de la Federación de Centros Agua. Una población de 4,500, la nacionalidad Agua, el idioma que hablamos es el Aguapil, difícil entenderlo.
So he greets you in the name of the Awá nationality, which is a double national, a binational nationality that lives both in Ecuador and Colombia. Afterwards, they put these little stripes and points, but actually they still feel that there's no divide between Ecuador and Colombia. They still live on both sides of the frontier. So he's the president of the Awá Federation of Ecuador, which is an organization that represents 22 Awá communities living on the frontier of Ecuador with Colombia, as said before. And they inhabit three different provinces of Ecuador, which is the province of Esmeraldas, the province of Carchi, and the province of Imbabura. The population of the Awás living in Ecuador amounts to 4,500 people. In Colombia, their number is much larger, and their language that they speak is called Aguapit.
Como todo movimiento indígena social en el Ecuador, complementando a la propuesta de nuestra compañera, no queremos redundar el tema y no ir consecuentemente hablando de ese tema. La Federación de Centros Agua del Ecuador, al tener varios impactos de diferentes índoles, Una de las estrategias es la construcción del plan de vida de la federación o de la nacionalidad agua. Esto implica definir políticas de Estado a nivel de la nacionalidad, definir políticas conjuntas establecidas del pueblo, de las que conforman la organización. Entre ellas tenemos acciones, propuestas para hacer el ejercicio realmente por una autonomía o una autodeterminación socioterritorial.
So similarly, as the Quechua people, the Awá people have been threatened by a series of issues that are threatening their territorial, their life in their territory. And they are actually already in a process of implementing and developing their life plans and trying to generate political incidents to insert these life plans into the political agendas of state. So what we see here, the picture you see here, is the way the Awás see the world and how the world originated. These are the four worlds that they consider within their cosmovision. And the development of their life plans is actually a political standpoint in which they are able to pronounce their self-determination within their territory based on this cosmovision, not based on the cosmovision of others.
Es el mapa del, en el Ecuador, ¿no? Del territorio como está ubicado. A pesar de ser un territorio que está en la frontera, nuestro territorio es apetecido a nivel mundial, a nivel nacional, ya que es, diríamos, son los remanentes biológicos, donde todavía encontramos bosques nativos, animales propios del lugar, en todo el sector del Chocó. Esto hace que también sea amenazado por diferentes niveles de gobierno, de los empresarios, mineros, palmicultores, etc.
What you see in this map is the territory, the 22 communities that compose the territory of the Awá Nation in Ecuador. What he mentions is that this territory is considered to be located in one of the hotspots of biodiversity, and it is the Awá territory specifically is one of the last remnants of the Chocó, of original primary Chocó rainforest. However, what he says is, in most cases, people, including the state and other NGOs and international development organizations, have only valued the natural resources and the biodiversity that exist in this territory without taking into account the social and cultural diversity that also exists within this territory.
Una de los lineamientos políticos que plantea la nacionalidad es la autogobernabilidad socioterritorial, ¿no? Esto se refiere al que los Awá no reconocemos una autoridad territorial en nuestro territorio colectivo. Dentro del territorio, a nivel tanto del Estado, hay gobiernos autónomos, nos centramos en el mismo nivel, todas las organizaciones, movimientos sociales, indígenas, campesinos y comunitarias, ¿no? Eso nos permite hacer ese ejercicio por los reconocimientos constitucionales en diferentes partes, ¿no? También como los convenios internacionales y la declaración de